gentlemen, now we will take a part in first plenary by Professor Tae Hyun Yoon, talking about bridging the gap between excellences in nano R&D and profits in nano industry. And Rika Trinarti, PhD, as the moderator in panel. We would like to invite Professor Tae Hyun Yoon and Rika Trinarti, PhD, to the stage.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, everyone. For this first plenary session, we would like to invite Professor Yoon Tae-hyun from Department of Chemistry and Scale Characterization and Environmental Chemistry Lab, Hanyang University, South Korea. Professor Yoon Tae-hyun graduated from Stanford University, USA, in 2004 with more than 50 publications. And today he would like to present research about bridging the gap between excellences in nano R&D and profits in nano industry. Please, time is yours.
Thank you for very nice introduction and good morning, everyone. As you introduced it, my name is Tae Hyun Yoon, and I am from Hanyang University, Department of Chemistry. And actually, I'm also recently like a maker, some startup company, which is and doing CEO of only one man company. So these days, during the last like a few years, I was thinking about how to like make those like research and development into some industry, like some profitable industry. So I made this title, The Bridging the Gap Between Excellences in Nano R&D and Profits in Nano Industry. And probably the answer at the end would be the toolbox for nanomaterial characterization and safety assessment. And the content will be, I will start with the characterization technique for engineered nanomaterials, and then the characterization of nanomaterials and nanoproducts throughout their life cycles, more complex systems. And then finish up with the nanoinformatics data set, descriptors, and prediction models for engineered nanomaterials. So first, let me start with the characterization of engineered nanomaterials. Maybe you already heard about the nanomaterials, and it's kind of a common word. But actually, we used to live with the nanomaterial for the last few thousand years, or from the beginning of the history. So there are natural nanoparticles. I think there are many like active volcano in Indonesia, and those volcanic ash is kind of natural nanoparticle. So we used to have them. And in Korea, in spring season, we have like a yellow dust from the continent, and we have some many problems, but it's seasonal, and we used to live for several thousand years. But in addition to those natural nanoparticles, we begin to have those incidental nanoparticles, which is from the diesel just, or maybe cooking, we also make nanoparticles. But these are something we can endure or we can handle. But recently, during the last like two decades or three decades, people are making new materials, new chemicals called quantum dot, carbon nanotube, TiO2 or nanogold, and making various functionality, some new properties. Oh, and people think, industry, think, oh, this is something new, and we can make money, we can make profit from these things. So once they think that it is useful for making profit, they just make, and maybe we have exponential growth in the engineer or manufacturer nanoparticles. So today I'd like to discuss about the advantages or disadvantages or pros and cons of engineered nanoparticles based on our characterizing techniques or data analysis techniques. And yesterday, I was sitting just here and attending the workshop between UI and NTNU. And I think Professor Liu have a very important message to you guys, like to be more like high impact, like scholars, to publish it in more high impact journals. What you have to do is you have to do like your research very hard, but at the same time, you have to work together, you have to collaborate. So when you work just by yourself, or when you collaborate with other universities, or when you collaborate with other countries, those average impact factor is going higher and higher. Actually, I'm from South Korea, and maybe you can find here, if your eyes are very good. So we are in the position in the peninsula, but actually we are island because we have oceans, east, west, south, and we have a big water in the north. So we cannot go to north. So we are kind of in a small island. So the only way we can survive is kind of go abroad. So we have been trying to do our best for doing data research, but we also like recognize that we cannot do just by ourselves. So one of the strategies our group have is participating in many international collaboration, and today I will show one example, which is called ACE Nano. Actually, ACE Nano is acronym of Analytical Characterization Excellence in Nanomaterial Risk Assessment, a tiered approach. And actually, this is a project and consortium in European countries. The EU Horizon 2020 project, which involved 10 countries and 28 partners, and it is funded like 13 million euros for 4 years. So from 2017 to 2020. And as you can see, the European government kind of recommend like international collaboration. So as an international collaborator, China, South Korea, Mexico was involved. And Harvard University participated in this ACE-NA consortium as an international collaborator with the University of Birmingham or Vienna, ETA, and other companies. So the reason we are doing this kind of collaboration is not just for money. Actually, we didn't get any funding from Europe because they consider South Korea as developed, and just they said, oh, you can fund yourself. So, and Korean government actually give us major funding. So it's not just for money. It's for making network, making meeting and doing collaborations. So within the ACE Nano, we have met many experts in UK or Germany, Switzerland or Austria or other countries, and they are also tightly connected with other European funders, such as this ENN Nano Redusa, other consortium in Europe, which have similar objectives. And this group of experts is playing a role in many international organizations. such as international standard organization, they may make protocols of some measurement, declaration. We have to go here and make some standard. And go through expert group, maybe many of them from these European countries, make decisions whether we can make protocols as standard or not. And those European regulation agency, or the more international collaboration through the OECD. So, when I say to do like a more impact, like a significant research, maybe it can be expressed by some high impact journals with impact factor 10, 20 or something like that. But I think the most important thing is the research outcomes from our lab may have some effect on real society. And the way we can do this is our analytical technique can be standardized and can be used in the regulation and can be used for international corporations, economic. So that's why we are doing collaboration with European countries, and there are several ways. There are some analytical techniques which are kind of quite well stabilized, but need some optimization and benchmarking. But for this part, we are doing participation in inter-laboratory testing of nanoparticle characterization techniques. And there are some areas which need some innovative method development. So in that case, there are many method development, and Hanyang University is leading the development and application of synchrotron-based subtractive spectrum microscope techniques. So these are what I will tell you today and also on Friday. So these are nanomaterials. So on your ocean to the, different from the chemicals, we need to know the size or shape, surface area, surface chemistry, agglomeration, dilution. So many other parameters, additional parameters, need to know to describe the nanoparticles. And since we are participating in this consortium, those experts in all different characterization areas, they get together and decide what parameter we need to measure, and to measure that parameters, what kind of technique is available. And among those techniques, they will kind of choose the priority for measuring size, or for measuring shape, or surface charge. Which technique is most stable or most feasible? And then we are doing and participating the interlaboratory comparisons and the particle characterizations. So, for example, the most basic one is the dynamic light spectrum and nanoparticle tracking systems, NTA and transmission electron microscopy, and also single particle. ICT mass spectrometry. So I will explain even more of this on the Friday, public lectures in the URLs. And I think this kind of interlaboratory comparison is kind of easy way to show, easy example of showing the high impact publications. So I'm just here. And I'm just participating in the TEM measurement to intercomparison, and they got 5 or 6 different laboratory and compare those results and publish it in PubMed, which is kind of a good impact factor. And since it's kind of result from multiple laboratory, it's more credited and reliable, considered as reliable. And it already become one of the ISO standards. So, for the simple or just characterization of nanomaterials, we can use those DLS or NTA or TEM or just the common techniques. But we also need to characterize nanomaterials or nanoproducts throughout their lifestyle. So once we make those engineered nanoparticles, those researchers or together groups try to make it more complex. Just make those building blocks into like more complex systems and make those nano components, or they can even make some electronics or like a consumables or cosmetics. So already many nanomaterials are already in our life. Maybe if you are using the sunscreen, then you already have some titanium dioxide or zinc oxide in those material as a nano form. So, but the question is, how can we quantify and characterize those nanomaterials in those nanoproducts or consumer materials products? And we will use those nanoproducts and also, and then throw out, and it will go to our environment. So those nanoparticles or nanoproducts will go to our oceans and lakes, and go to some food chains, and maybe it will go back to us, and may affect our ecosystem, as well as our human health. But how can we assume that they are kind of circulating throughout this cycle? But we don't know how, and how those nanoparticles exist in this system. So analyzing those things are kind of a difficult part. So for doing that, we need kind of a new novel techniques, and the technique I'm supposed to suggest is like today in the soft space and plastic microscopy, which have nanoscale resolution and chemical species and characteristics, and we can do imaging, and also we can do in situ analysis. So this is kind of a map showing the front page of the technique with the axis of spatial resolution and with the axis of like the chemical information. As you know, the SAM-PAM electron microscope technique show very good spatial resolution down to nanometers, but they don't have any chemical information. And infrared, Raman, or other techniques, they have a very rich in chemical information. But as you know, those infrared visible, they are limited by their wavelengths for the spatial resolution, so they cannot go down to less than like a 200 nanometer or 300 nanometers. So actually what we want to go is high resolution and high chemical information. And for doing that, we think one of those soft X-ray spectral nanoscopy is the best candidate. And soft X-ray, they have a shorter wavelengths for better resolution, and also they contain various absorption edges which can tell us the chemical bonding properties, oxidation state, or balance bond structures of molecules or atoms. So for doing that, we need a synthesis. We are using X-rays, and we need some bright X-rays. So for this application, like in South Korea, we have a light source called like a Pohang light source, and it generates very bright, like very intense light, X-rays. And at the end of the beam line, we have this kind of instrument to do those sticks. And if we compare the brightness of the X-rays, if we are using X-rays in the laboratory to do XRD, X-ray diffraction measurement, so the scale is, the brightness is about this order, but the Pohang light source is in this order, and this is third generation, and this is fourth generation, and the Y-axis is global scale, so it's 10 to the 18 times, like more bright, so that you can do more experience, more accurate, more quicker, and within short time. And the current resolution is around 10 nanometer or even less. And this is an example of a single bacteria, that this is a single bacteria which change ions to iron oxidation state. So we can pair proteins or extracellular polysaccharides or carbonate or ferrous iron, different chemical species into chemical weapons. So for the stickstone, we have a high spatial resolution, in situ observation capability, and chemical information together. So I think, although we are not at this end yet, but stickstone is about this level, so it will be helpful to do research in like in this complex system. And this kind of stickstone is available like in South Korea and also Shanghai and Switzerland and UK or Canada and USA. There are many stickstone instruments available, just free of, not completely free of charge. You need to have some travel cost. So we are doing this kind of research. Sometimes we go to Canada in the during the winter when we have like minus 30 Celsius. And sometimes we come to like Korea or Switzerland to do this experiment. For details, I think I can explain more on Friday. So those synchrotron-based soft texture like spectral nanoscopy, we have this kind of capability. And one example I'd like to show is from our second PhD in our group, the Dr. No, that he was interested in photonic crystals. And he tried to characterize the photonic crystals using soft texture techniques. And for those who is not familiar with the photonic crystals, maybe you have seen these beautiful colored butterflies or other insects, some natural colors. And you may think the butterfly have some blue pigment, but actually it is not. Actually the color is blue colors or green colors. These are all structural colors. They have some nanostructures within their like a wing, and this nanostructure interacts with the light and interfere and make some special colors. So we can kind of follow these kind of protocols and make our own colors, and that's the way we make like a photonic crystals. We arrange it like a nanoparticles in a certain way and making certain structures, and can make various colors which can be used to many display and other like, electronic applications. But the problem was, for the photonic crystals, there are many ways to characterize, but for the electron microscopy, TEM can show only the cross-sections, and SEM show on the surface. So if there's a defect deep inside, or like a line defect deep inside, and if there are some small like structures within the crystals, we cannot find it by the electron microscopy. And we may use confocal or optical microscope, but their resolution is limited by the like the diffraction limit. So they have like a 200 or 300 nanometer resolution limit. So we think X-ray microscopy could be a good alternative because it has decent resolution, such as like a 10 to 20 nanometers, and it can penetrate much deeper than electron microscopy, so you can see inside the photonic crystals. So there is a comparison of techniques in Dr. Noh's publications. But actually, as you can see, in this small area, you can see some parts like from their image analysis, you can see that in this part, this is FCC structure, and this side is HCT structure. And you can see some defect inside the structures, and point defect, and also some line defect in various areas. And this is another more clear example of line defect. And you can also tomography for better resolutions. And we can even apply for the binary cloning system. So you have larger nanoparticles and smaller nanoparticles with different compositions and showing their like the structures, local defective, or the structural distributions in the photonic crystals. So this is an example of 50 nanometer polystyrene. And the previous one was about 100 nanometer, like silica. And this is FPCC-100 structure with silica and polystyrene. And this is the structures. So we have shown that this soft X-ray technique can be used for the characterization of like photonic crystals and their nanostructures, particularly for those for their local defective like structures. And another one I would like to show you is I have a like a friend working on the like memories, and he and I have collaborated like through my graduation piece, my like third PhD from my group. And he worked with my like a friends group in the electronic department, and they make some flexible like a memory. And what they did is that typically they have active materials of TiO2 or other metal oxide in this thin layer as a memory. But they replaced them with the graphene oxide and make it work and also make it flexible. So they made some graphene oxide thin film for flexible non-volatile memory applications. Actually, and after this work, we are thinking that, oh, how about doing these studies more in situ? So we made these memories. We fabricated this memory device into this silicon nitride substrate and doing measurement of soft X-ray measurement and like switching those memory at the same time and observing those electric signals as well as their spectroscopic signals. And we can see there are some areas of defective which kind of accelerate the degradation of the like, memories and try to understand those systems, why they have those changes. And we can explain them those as movement of oxygen from the graphene oxide to the interfacial layers. And this is an example. And this guy, this funny guy, is the first PhD in our group. You know, she was very funny. And he just came in our group, and I want to do environmental science, and telling me maybe like examples of his study, and I said, oh, it will take maybe 5 PhD. Well, actually, he finished his PhD 6 years, fortunately, and his interest was how those nanoparticles kind of cycling throughout those food chains. And he was interested in this small creature, which is called Daphnia. And he was looking at how those nanoparticles are moving, I mean, like digested in these small creatures. And he was very mean. He just cut these small creatures and have a cross-sections for TEM measurement. And you can see their intestines. And after the exposure to the nanoparticles, those intestines, the intestine is kind of damaging. And also, what he showed is those typical nanoparticles, such as TiO2, is not actually getting inside the their organism as a in the form of like a nanoparticle. Actually, they are moving throughout, like as a, in the form of like ions, but not the nanoparticles. But for some of the nanoparticles, they kind of damage it those biological systems, even though they are not killing those materials, those organisms. And you can even perform those things by using their spectroscopic pictures and combine with the TEM measurement. So, even though I explained very briefly, those subtextile spectral nanoscopy technique can do chemical nanoscale or in-situ imaging like analysis, which can be applied to opening crystals, memory device, or nanotoxicity studies. And let's go back to original questions. How can you bridge the gap between this nano-R&D? We are doing analytical or material for many different areas. And when we have sort of good publication or good patent and try to talk to the industry people, this is a old CEO of some company, and, oh, this is great, like a breakthrough, and let's commercialize this. Then let's see his face. He has some questions. So how can you make money? How can you make money from this thing? We have to make it like it's more difficult for doing R&D and more difficult to make it profitable than just doing publications. So most of the question they have is can be solved by systematically collecting those research data and make it like useful for industry or other experts. So we are trying to make some kind of by using various information technology, we are trying to make a toolbox for nanomaterial characterization and safety assessment. And this is also part of the ACE Nano project, and we have this kind of S2 nano filters. So from here, we can use and the data and those organized protocols can be available in some IT infra systems and also can be used to for registration of chemicals or nanomaterials or some kind of regulation compliance. So this is our portal for those nanosafety or nanomaterials. Here you can see those various measurement techniques. And let me first question when you have nanomaterial and bring it to the industry, if they ask you, is this nano? What's the difference? Anyone? Actually, there is no a single definition of nano, but all those ISO or OECD have a definition of operational definition, between 1 to 100 nanometer in one of the three dimensions, and those number of particles or number of nanomaterials mean more than 50% or 10%. So there are some operational definition of nano, and that will determine whether you have to register your materials to the government, European government, or the Korean government, or Chinese government, if you want to export it. So that kind of the system is already used in this system. So if you have a TEM data, you can use it and upload this kind of TEM data, and you can get this kind of whether your material is here, so it's kind of hard to see whether your material is here, test type and silk, gamma, based on the European regulation or Korean regulation. So TEM, TLS, and other things. But I think more important thing for the industry people is how can we make nanomaterials like more efficiently. So in chemicals, for like pharmaceutical companies, they are doing the drug design technique by using various models and predictive techniques. So I think for the nanomaterials or functional nanomaterials, we can do similar ways by collecting the data and making the predictive models. And throughout their cycles, throughout their development cycles, we can use those predictive models and can maybe make it more efficient for the safety or functionality assessment. So that's why we need the nanoinformatics. We need to collect the data set and the descriptors and prediction models for the continuous nanomaterials. And I will stop this. Actually, it's for the chemicals. We have a count like a chemical space. How many chemicals we have in the world? Maybe it's hard to count. But according to this information, currently the registered chemicals is about 60 million. And actually, theoretically, for less than 100 and 500 molecular histology, 10 to the 60 molecules. So there are huge number of chemicals. And how about nanomaterials? And how many different nanomaterials we may have? So for those problems. So we can now synthesize or test all those nanomaterials. So similar to the a drug design or a chemical communities, we can do some predicting models for the nanomaterial safety as well as functionality. So for doing that, we have data separation and quality and completeness assessment and nanosurfaceification model development in our group. So we have data collection steps, processing and model development, and large extraction steps, and from the physical-chemical measurement, we get these kind of data. And also some biological assessment, we can get cell viability. And from the literature, we also collect a lot of data from the published research. And these are kind of a number of articles or experiments we have collected, which is it's about 22,000, but now it's 33,000 data. And by using these data sets, we of course embedded it into the database system, and we can sort and kind of filtering and do some data set processing. And it's kind of hard to see, but from this database, we have selected about 216 nanoparticles with 26 oxide nanoparticles, and it has about 6,000 or 7,000 data rows. So from these data rows, and we have gap filling or data screening of the data set to make it better and better. And by using those data capability methods, we have actually refined the data set. And by using this data set, we can do make a model. And as you may heard from these days, there are several algorithms we can develop predictive models of random forests, support vector machines, or backpropagation, or neural network, those machine learning or deep learning algorithms that were used to develop the models for the nano property assessment. And these are mothers we have together from the agency. It's kind of hard to see from the screen, but the accuracy of these mothers is about 80% to 95%. And some of those mothers were published in these public literature, and you can also find these things. And also we embedded these mothers and data sets into the web-based portals. And now you can kind of choose these modules and just add type of materials and some properties, and you can say, you can see kind of whether it is safe or unsafe in terms of survival. And then also you can show what kind of public domain that you can use for this model so that it could be more user-friendly and safe for applications. So these are what we are doing with the collected data from the Facebook different measurements, and we make that for curated data set and make a classification or regression models based on this data set and use it for the vector design by safety or functionality. So I think we can use novel nanomaterial design by its safety and functionality by using these nano-QSAR models. And also, hopefully, in the future, we can do regulation compliance of nanomaterials and nanoproducts by using these nano-QSAR models. And I think these are some pictures. And actually, what we are trying to do is, so we have many people with excellent outcomes in R&D, but there are still a lot of gap between us and the nano industry. And by using those characterization techniques and advanced information technology, we can make some bridges between these two islands. And these works were supported by the Korean Ministry of Trade, Industry and Energy, and many collaborators in Korea, as well as collaborators in Europe. And thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Yu Tengyun. And for the next 10 minutes, we have a discussion for the question and answer session. Actually, this nanomaterial kind of thing is probably all of the device that we use mostly come from the nanomaterial. So it should be very interesting for us to see how those materials can relate to the industrial application, but also with the concern about the environmental itself. Safety. So through the system, the S2 nano, the system will bring the data for the nano safety data gap, and then for the development of the nano safety database itself. I would like to offer you to open some question for Professor Yu. Maybe first three question from the audience.
Yeah. this new engineer about the loss? Is it toxic? Is it something like that? Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your numbers that you get from the scholars.
See you in this very interesting talk. I'm for my question is about PS and transmission experience. So it's very interesting to me, can we have a very low transmission and then also use the idea of the chemical information. Have you or do you know any information from this one? This technique has been used for example in areas of analysis where you have micro
For the cell culture base of microscopy,
possible for us to check for the detailed information about the potential energy on the surface material from this first preliminary talk. The spectroscopy soft X-rays in the drop is one of the methods for the structural characterization of isolated species of complexity from the molecule until the nanoparticle with using high-resolution studies of the molecule. And then the S2 nano is one of the methods to bridge the nanosafety data gap between R&D activities and industrial application by providing a toolbox for nanomaterial characterization and safety assessment by using the nanosafety database and by predicting model and then also the user-friendly interface system. And I would like to say thank you very much for the very interesting presentation for this first plenary session, and let's have a big applause for Professor Yu.
Okay, for Professor Taehyun Yoon, please remain on the stage to take a photo with the Dean of FMIPA UI. Okay, so probably yes. Okay, Professor Taehyun Yoon, please go to the stage and the Dean of FMIPA UI will give souvenirs. Thank you to Professor Taehyun Yoon and Dr. Renat Abdul Haris.